Do you ever feel like you're just taking the same old nature photos over and over again? We've all been there. It happens to all of us. And today I want to share with you some ideas about how to get out of that rut and produce images that really pop. So let's get into my top 11 tips for nature photos with impact. Why 11 instead of 10? Well, it's one better, isn't it? Hola amigos, Greg Basco here in my hotel room at the beautiful Hotel Bougainvillea, which is one of my favorite hotels in Costa Rica. We at Foto Verde Tours, my tour company here, use this for the beginning and ending day for all of our workshops in Costa Rica. And the Hotel Bougainvillea is just beautiful. Right outside my window over here is this spacious acres of beautiful tropical garden with birds and insects and orchids, passion flowers. The staff are wonderful and friendly. The food is great, and it's just a beautiful retreat outside of the hustle and bustle of Costa Rica's capital city. So thanks to the Hotel Bougainvillea for letting me do a couple days of peaceful work on YouTube and some other photo articles right here at the hotel. Be sure to check out the Hotel Bougainvillea if you're going to be visiting Costa Rica. So today's video is all about offering you some ideas that you can incorporate easily into your own nature photography in order to help you produce images that kind of stand out from the crowd, that get you excited, that get other people excited. I'm not talking about crazy viral ways like, tying up frogs until they're doing karate kicks with fishing line and stuff like that happens, replacing skies, whatever. That's all fine. Digital art is all fine. But I'm not talking about that today. Tying up frogs to make them do karate kicks is not fine, no matter how you cut it, by the way. But we're not going to talk about that. I'm talking more about things that are some technical things you can do in your photography and some other things that use the power of your mind and kind of your vision when you're out in the field. And one of the first ones is dramatic skies. You want to always look for dramatic skies. And if you're lucky to find a dramatic sky, it can turn even a relatively mundane foreground or foreground object into a winning picture. So anytime you think you're going to have some dramatic skies, start looking immediately for what you can place against those skies, and you're going to have a winning picture, even if you don't have the most epic foreground ever. Tip number two, I should stop doing that because once I get to 11, what happens then? Tip number two is to always look for strong compositions. I know that sounds cliche. We've heard about composition a million times, right? But we tend to forget it as landscape photographers sometimes when we're just in front of this beautiful scene and everything's so amazing and majestic. We still really need to think about composition. Even more importantly, when we're photographing birds or wildlife, even with a telephoto lens, you know, we tend to just get excited about getting something right in the frame, but we can still think about even with tighter, you know, portrait type shots or tighter animal shots, we can still think about things that add to the composition. Maybe it's some swirly leaves in the background. Maybe it's some vegetation or hills that just give that little something where the animal is then part of a composition instead of just one bird on a straight stick or that sort of thing, or a bear standing in a grassy field where there's nothing really going on. So a strong composition can elevate any photo from ho-hum to a real winner. Tip number three, don't shoot at f8. You know, that's one of those old rules that you used to read about, like in old photo magazines. I'm not that old, but you hear these things. f8 and be there, I think is what they used to say. There's nothing wrong with f8. It's a perfectly respectable aperture. It offers relatively good depth of field, and it's often the sharpest aperture on our lenses. But, you know, people tend to take this to heart because they think, especially when shooting with telephoto lenses or even in macro for macro subjects, that we need everything in focus, from a bird's eye back to the tail feathers, from a frog's eye back to the back legs, all this sort of thing, that you need everything in focus. And you'll hear that sometimes in camera clubs, and you might want to adhere to it if that's what they're looking for. But to my way of thinking, having everything in focus is not usually a plus. In fact, I think you can draw more attention to your subject a lot of times by only focusing on the eye or only focusing on a part of the subject. It also allows you to shoot through vegetation, you know, because another thing, we're always trying as bird and wildlife photographers to get a really clear look at a subject. But I will intentionally seek out things where I'm shooting through vegetation so I can get this kind of blurry, kind of dreamy effect a window into a subject. And if only the head's in focus, that's just fine. And those are the types of images that people remember more than a standard shot. Tip number four. This one seems a little crazy. Look for bad light. This is something I do a lot in my photography. You know, with telephoto work or macro work, you can get great backlit shots, side lit shots. You can create that with flash. Upcoming tip, by the way. But you really want to look for light that most, you know, that photographers would say, oh, this light is just bad. I'm not even going to shoot it. That's when I start to get excited because you can produce images that are really different and stand out. And even in landscapes, harsh midday light, if you can isolate parts of your scene and get these deep blacks and just a few highlights, you can really do some amazing work in bad light. So anytime you hear the other photographers around you complaining that this light sucks and it's horrible and they're going to pack it up, I suggest you stay out there and find something cool to photograph, whether it's with your macro lens, your wide angle lens, or your telephoto lens. Tip number five, include the environment in your pictures whenever you can. If there are attractive surroundings, try to include those rather than just always going full in tight with your macro lens or, you know, getting and filling the frame as much as you can with your telephoto lens and having these poster board smooth backgrounds. Those can be nice shots. I'm happy to have a few in my portfolio. But whenever there's something interesting in the environment, I'll try to maybe back away or zoom out or use a wider angle lens if a creature will allow me to get close, or you can do it with plants too. But anytime you can include the environment, it's going to make up for a much more interesting picture. So step back, zoom out, or don't moan about the fact that you don't have enough focal length. When I don't have enough focal length, I look at that as an opportunity to take a different type of bird or wildlife photo. Tip number six. It's all about action, you know? Some people only shoot action, and I don't think that's the way to go. Beautiful classic portraits of a still subject can be fantastic photos, and we should seek those out whenever possible. But when we see some action, whether it's things flying around, jumping around, something eating something else, or even just something eating fruit or eating some flowers, all those sorts of things, that little bit of action can really make for photos that stand out. So anytime you see an animal doing something, get out there and try to make a cool picture. Tip number seven is about thinking about color when we're out photographing. I think the first recorded notes about color, systematic notes kind of, were in some old 14th century notebooks of Da Vinci's. I don't just know that off the top of my head. I Googled it, man. But, you know, seriously, this kind of color theory has been around for a while. Da Vinci actually included black and white in his color scheme. But if we think about the mood that colors can set, you know, if you want a cooler mood, you want a warmer, more energetic mood, all those sorts of things, and then the way colors relate to each other. For instance, you know, blue and orange can really just pump up the saturation. So complementary colors. Really think about those, whether you're shooting landscapes, macro, even wildlife and birds, and those can really make your images pop right off the screen if you're thinking about color. All right, those of you who know me knew I wasn't going to make it through an entire video without mentioning flash, and tip number eight is I recommend that you learn to use flash. You know, flash can just open up so many new creative worlds to you as a nature photographer. It can allow you to create your own light. It can allow you to tame or improve suboptimal light. But either way, it's going to allow you to take photos that will amaze your friends and family and all of your Instagram followers and your Facebook followers and your magazine editors, whatever you're doing. Flash is just going to make you a better nature photographer, and it's going to make you a better student of natural light, by the way, too. On that subject, if you'd like to learn much more, check out the link in the description below to my latest ebook, Flash for the Nature Photographer. So I love flash, but flashlights, continuous lights, are also a really cool thing to have in our photography bag when we're out in the field. You know, we can use a flashlight to add a little backlight to a mushroom, a little side light to a plant. We can light up a larger scene at night where we're light painting. There's all sorts of stuff that you can do with continuous lights. And there are so many out there now, and you don't need anything fancy. You can just use a little pocket flashlight, the cheapest one you can find. You can get some fancy RGB color switching lights if you'd like. I have some in the backgrounds of my videos, that, and I'm going to use those out in the field too. But whatever you can get your hands on, buy a cheap flashlight, buy a couple of little LED lights and things like that. Get out in the field and play around with them. It's a really nice way to learn, in some ways easier than learning flash, because you get a live preview of what's going on as you move your lights around. So it's a really good way to learn lighting and shadows. Tip number 10, injecting an element of storytelling into any photo is going to be a huge bonus. And to do that, you really need to get to know your subject's behavior, a little bit about the ecology of where your subject lives or the place you're photographing, and all that knowledge will help you to tell people about what you're seeing and what you're trying to interpret through your photos. And it's going to make your photos much more interesting. And not only that, you can start to put them together as a collection that tells a story about a subject or about a place. And finally, tip number 11, sharpness is overrated. Yeah, I said it. I want you to learn how to take blurry pictures. Not intentionally blurry, although cool painterly abstract blurs are really cool too, and I would put that under this tip. Give it a try. It's not as easy as you might think because you still have to think about some things, whether it's trees out in the forest and you're moving up and down, or a bird flying. You still have to have good technique and a nice artistic eye. But you can also portray motion through a mix of sharpness and blur. You could mix flash with long shutter speeds and ambient light, which is one of my favorite techniques here in the rainforest or wherever I travel. So, knock it off with all the sharp pictures, even though you paid $10,000 for that fancy lens, and get blurry. All right, I hope you enjoyed this quick video with my top 11 tips. If you like these tips, you might be interested in having them in ebook form. I did a little free ebook based around all this stuff a few years ago. How can you get that ebook? Just go to my deepgreenphotography.com website, go to the subscribe page, sign up for the newsletter, confidential, free, and I'll send you a download link for the ebook. But I hope I gave you some ideas that you can think about putting into practice the next time you get out into the field to do some nature photography. I'm really excited to get back out in the field with clients. I have my Pelican case packed right behind me, and tomorrow morning I'm heading out with our first workshop since the pandemic began here in Costa Rica. It's going to be a great time, and I'm super excited to be working with clients again. If you'd like to join me, say, over the next year and a half in Costa Rica, in Ecuador, or in Chile, check out the link below, deepgreenphotography.com/workshops. And see what I have on tap. I'd love to meet you out in the field. Until next time, take care.